would think that they are ahead of string theory in some sense, that the topological band theory has real impact in experiments. So we have to come up with that algorithm, that why it has more value than just a theory. Okay, so as you say, that my pointer has died again. These invariants, if you follow the theory, they are telling you that just by the invariants, they're not transport is not topologically quantized. So if you try to do transport measurement in the good old von Klitzing way, then you will see just again his old stuff. You'll see integer quantum Hall state, right? So, but then, how do you measure this invariant? How do you know that these invariants actually exist? Because they're quite subtle. They're related to the parity of the wave function. We need far more subtle and delicate experimental tools for doing that. So our algorithm, in some way, it's a brute force, but it's very thorough. So we are saying that, okay. So it's about topological classification of electron band insulators. So it's the electron is the central character here. So what are the degrees of freedom electrons have? They have spin, they have momentum, they have energy, they can live on the surface, they can live on the bulk. So if I can come up with a technique that can probe, that can tell you whether they're living on the surface, they're living on the bulk, what is their spin doing, what is their momentum doing, what is their energy doing, that's all the quantum numbers, those quantum numbers completely, absolutely, categorically will characterize that state. So whether they're topological, non-topological, they're superconducting, they're magnet or whatever, you'll trace that state. So that's our technique. And so we applied that technique to provide a thorough and extensive proof of topological state. So this is one way of doing it, but there are other response functional way of doing it. Yes, question?
I thought the classification was Z or Z2 for any dimension symmetry classes. So how are you getting...
I'm talking about 3D. 3D and 2D and Z2 classification. I'm not talking about superconductors here now.
Well, I just remember the periodic table. There's either Z, Z2, or 0 there.
Yeah.
You're getting this sort of Z16. Where is that?
No, this is Z2 classification.
Because you have translation symmetry in addition. So you get more than just the Z2. Okay.
Yeah. So I'm talking about experiments. The crystals, of course, have they're defined by translational symmetry, right? So, okay. So there is a response function way of identifying that 3D topological insulator, and that is the magnetoelectric effect. So there is a magnetoelectric quantization. So this is, then you have to think of more in a topological field theory sense, and it's also connected to Witten effect and all sorts of very interesting high energy concept type effect. So this is, but ultimately what these measurements are theoretically proposed to tell you is that whether theta is pi, it's odd, or the nu naught is odd or not. Let me try this one, okay. Yeah. So, but these experiments are extremely difficult, and even when they're done, they're going to tell you just the first invariant. They're not going to tell you what the other invariants are. And these other invariants are quite interesting, especially when you try to push them, realizing topological superconductivity. So I want to make sure that. Thanks. It's not missed that, yes, there is another way of measuring the first invariant, which is interesting, very interesting, and magnetoelectric quantization come from that. But we are giving a complete solution, and we already gave you that, but doing that, we are also trying to realize that. It's not easy. So now first, since many people think that was the case in early days of topological insulator, they were thinking that the because of the extrinsic doping of the materials, the transport is not happening, and the good old ways of thinking of topological phenomena was the transport way, like quantum integer, quantum Hall type of thing. So I want to first show some transport results. I want to show some recent results rather than earlier results. Many people have worked on it. So let's say transport is happening, that samples are very good, in a very good condition. It's not like they're not, people in those days used to say topological insulators are not insulators. What they meant is that there is unintentional extrinsic doping, meaning that the material quality is not good enough to get surface state signal in transport. That has long been solved. I mean, that's why I'm presenting that result first before going to spectroscopy. So since all of you, most of you probably already know quantum Hall effect very well, integer quantum Hall effect. So now if you do transport on the surface of a topological insulator, you have on the surface of a topological insulator, you have a Dirac gas. If the system is not interesting, that's why I'm calling it Dirac gas or Dirac electron system, right? So you have 2D electron system on the surface of a topological insulator. So then if you do a quantum Hall type transport, you'll get signal from a 2D electron gas. In this case, it's not a trapped quantum Hall state in between two high purity semiconductors, but you're getting that from. So in other words, it has been demonstrated that you can get integer quantum Hall signal, very beautiful signal, from a 3D topological insulator surface. But then your top and bottom surface will always contribute together. So then, yes, your top surface is half quantized in some way. So then you'll get, so your lambda level spectrum will look like you have half from here, from top surface, other half from bottom. End of the day, you'll have integer quantum Hall effect. Now, look back, forget about the theory of topological insulator, just look at the data, transport data. If you look at the transport data, you cannot tell anything new about this sample. Okay, there is some sort of surface state, and this surface state shows integer quantum Hall effect. So that's their response function manifestation. So then there's no way to tell that the, are these Z2 quantized, or there's no way to tell. So in other words, even if transport is happening, and it has happened, and then the samples are almost perfectly insulating as it can get, but you're not going to, from transport, you're not going to get anything more than that. So our contribution is that we prepared the materials in a way and characterized and showed that in these class of topological insulators, the Fermi level is inside the gap and they're fairly stable, and then these parameters taken from the surface band structure could be used to interpret the transport. So in other words, the transport manifestation is just that you have integer quantum Hall state. How do you know it's a new state of matter? Okay. So in that sense, the insulating topological insulator already existed when we first did the experiment. That's because we do experiments in ultra-high vacuum, and then you don't have, we can control the contaminant on the surface, we can gate the surface chemically and all of that. So we could place the Fermi level at the Dirac point or inside the gap. So in this sample you have Fermi level in the conduction band, so this would be a metallic topological insulator, this would be insulating, this would be insulating. Where the surface transport would somewhat look like graphene because you're near the Dirac point. So the, in the theoretical sense, the bulk insulating intrinsic topological insulators existed from day one, but transport did not happen, but it has now happened, but it only gave you integer quantum Hall. So there is no way to tell whether they are different, from, but just by based on the experiment alone that the samples are realize a new state of matter Charlie invented. So this is, yeah.
Just so I'm clear, you have this three-dimensional sample of this something.
Yeah.
You're applying an electric field through this, a magnetic field through this sample, and you're just looking at the surface state, right? Because you said it's a quantum Hall.
Well, I mean, in this geometry. In this whole geometry, so there is a, there is a filling control of the top and bottom surface and all of that.
But you're calling it the quantum Hall effect, so I'm assuming there's a magnetic field perpendicular.
Yeah, of course. There is a magnetic field, yes. I'm saying that there is additional control. We're also controlling the filling.
Okay.
filling of the band. I'll get to that later. Let's move on. Yeah. Yes, the short answer to your question is yes, there is a magnetic field. It's not without magnetic field. So the magnetic field already broke time reversal, so you'll see a char number in your measurement. That's what you see if you do transport. Yeah.
So this is the new norm, like the first topological number you're saying. You see this is non-trivial, you don't know about the rest.
Yeah, but then this is, no, I'm saying that this is, that measurement is experiment alone, as an experimentalist. I want to just look at the data and be able to tell something strange has happened, the paradigm shift has happened. I cannot tell, that's what all I'm saying. Doing transport, at least many colleagues in transport community agree with me on that. So this is the detail microscope. So now we are using a microscopic detail of these states. Is that state distinct? Yeah.
Sorry, just out of curiosity, has anybody seen evidence of fractional quantum Hall in the...
Not in an agreed upon sense. People post very papers in the archive here and there, but I don't think there is a consensus on that in the community. But this is not ruled out. This is not ruled out. I mean, there's no reason it should not happen. I mean, it has to be reproducible. It has to walk like a duck, quack like a duck, and behave like a duck. I mean, all those duck behavior has not happened yet. But there are claims, yes. Okay, so...
Actually, one more thing.
Yeah, yeah.
I know that if you have two different topological phases, you will necessarily have states on
yeah,
the boundary.
Trapped, yes.
But if you see states on the boundary, does that necessarily imply that the two...
You have to know about the nature of that state. You have to know that fermion, what are all the quantum numbers that describe that fermion. And that will tell you whether that's a topological effect or not. I mean, just, you can have trivial fermions trapped. In fact, we see that in experiments all the time.
Right. So
yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, but that's why I said that you need a comprehensive experimental check, that we are the first to introduce that idea, that you need a comprehensive check.
And that would involve checking all of these numbers?
Yeah, you need to know the spin of the electron, all the quantum numbers that fermion.
And if you can show that at least one of them is non-trivial, you know you have...
Yes. Yeah. Huh? Yeah, so I'm a bit behind, so I have to take still some time from the second lecture to complete this one. The topological part is the most, so I have to bring in a lot of ideas, so later on it will get better. Okay, so what is the experimental challenge then? So we, as I said, we have to show that what are the boundary edge or surface states with all the resolution that is possible in all degrees of freedom, and is there a topological phase transition? In other words, when we say topological insulator, if it is a new state of matter, it must be distinct from a conventional band insulator through a topological phase transition. Otherwise, it's not new. So we have to prove that. How can we tune and can we go back and forth between, take a band insulator, turn it into topological, and or topological turn it into band insulator, and all of that. So all these thorough checks have to be there. So let me, since I'm short on time, let me move forward. So this is a bit historical thing, how we got into it. I had no clue. I was working on correlated electron systems, and at some point I had a DOE grant to work on thermoelectric with Bob Kava, and then we were working on these materials. Actually, the original material is tin dope, bismuth antimony. And then we saw that these things have bulk Dirac cone and some sort of surface state. And typically in ARPES measurements, when you see a surface state, you can get rid of them by tuning the surface, because surface state is fragile. So if you anneal the surface or dope something on it, surface states are not stable. They disappear. And then when we are doing these experiments, we were disappointed because the surface state was making things complicated. We could not see the bulk because we wanted to make connection to the thermoelectric property of the material because of the bulk. And then around that time, we became aware of Charlie's prediction. His prediction was in bismuth antimony type material, no tin in there. This data had tin in there. And then he was predicting that the surface states in this material would be very robust. You cannot get rid of them. And that's precisely what was happening years before in our experiment, that for some reason we could not cure the surface state, get rid of them, no matter what we do. So we gave up on it. That's why we never wrote up, because my experimentalist colleagues would not believe us that you cannot get rid of the surface states. But that turned out to be interesting, but since we tried all of those methodologies experimentally, so that we were preparing for studying topological insulators before knowing what is coming. So we were all prepared for that. So when we understood that this is precisely what should be happening, then that is very exciting. So the basic idea, what it is that we were doing, we are seeing that according to band calculation, the bulk band calculation, only this Dirac cone should be there, massive Dirac cone. There should not be this tiny signal. So we were worried about that tiny signal. It's supposed to be a semiconductor. It should be gapped. Why there is a Fermi surface in the system? So then what we did is that we tried to measure, is this Fermi surface two-dimensional or three-dimensional? So that check in ARPES, what we do, we tune, we move in the KZ axis, out of plane momentum axis, and see if the band is dispersing, that signal is dispersing in KZ, then we see that then those electrons have three-dimensional dispersion relation. Otherwise, when I change K sub Z, momentum in the perpendicular direction, where their energy would change. Whereas, this is the well-behaved band, we see that they are three-dimensional. When we change KZ, their energy change. But we saw that this tiny signal at the Fermi level, it doesn't change. It's always there as we change photon energy. So this is KZ independent, but KX and KY dependent. So that means they're two-dimensional, right? So the experimental character is that they are two-dimensional, and they don't disperse in 3D. So that is telling us they're at least 2D. They may not be surface state. They may be a buried bulk state that has accidental two-dimensionality. But then the strange thing is why do you think that we were having so much trouble? That's because in Charlie's prediction, he just said this would be a topological insulator. He did not actually calculate what would be the spectrum. So we did not have anything to compare with. And it's a very messy system. So without any calculation, we had to figure out how to prove that experimentally. So what did we do? Next, we wanted to do, okay, let's exhaust all the possibilities. Let's do the spin measurement. If we assign the spin texture on this Fermi surface, how do they look? Do they look any different? None of that was actually calculated by anyone. Even to this date, nobody has succeeded in calculating this thing. So we had to do all the hard work figuring out with all the details. So what we did, we saw that, okay, it's nice that the Fermi level is actually in the bulk gap. There is no conduction band here. And these are all two-dimensional states. They're surface states. So what we found, like your question, that yes, in the interface, there can be a trivial state. So this is how we've isolated that. So when we assigned the spin, we saw that the central pocket of Fermi surface, it has the spin was moving, co-moving with as we move on the Fermi surface, as we move the detector there, right, and measure. But whereas on the satellite pockets, the spin, as we walk on the Fermi surface, the satellite, the polarization doesn't move, but it moves globally. So in other words, there is no baryphase associated with these pockets, but there is a baryphase associated with those, the central pocket. So this is answer to one of your questions. At the interface, yes, there are trivial fermions also there. So how do you isolate that? In the absence of any calculation from anyone, this is what we did. It's a very painful measurement, but it paid off. We could get a Nature and Science paper out of it. So then we immediately knew that these pockets do not contribute to any baryphase. The only thing that contributes is the central one, and we look down in energy, we see that the central pockets meet. So then we figured out, just 1 minute, I'll take 1 minute to finish up this part. So then, once we figured out this is the only thing matters, and these are trivial surface states, these are trivial fermion trapped at the interface, we know that we can localize them by the chemistry principle. That's what we were trying to do before we knew about